Dr. Breyer, welcome to the program where diamonds are forever, but natural accommodation unfortunately isn't. Let's get right into your presentation then.
So let's start with the first slide. Well, whenever I want to solve a problem, I look to isolate the problem first and then look for the isolation and the solution. I learned that from Einstein. I think it's a very good idea to approach a solution problem process like that. The problem in presbyopia correction, the patient's view, either you wear progressive glasses, and we know the picture on the right-hand side, when you wear progressive glasses, you don't see the steps. People can fall over on the steps, or if you have to work overhead like the craftsmen and engineers, it might be difficult. If you wear multifocal contact lenses, you're wearing it in a time when many people have dry eye anyway, though they're not really happy about it. And if you add and summarize the costs over 20 or 30 years of progressive glasses, surgery, of course, is much cheaper. Let's have a look at the doctor's view. What is the problem in IOL surgery, as we already talked about? We have no accommodative optics we can use today on a daily basis, so we always have a compromise in visual quality. That means with whatever we are doing, we achieve photopic phenomena, and with that we might have unhappy patients. And as refractive surgery is completely different from cataract surgery, it's a turnaround in the relationship of patient and doctor. If you're not perfect on the point and not fulfilling the patient's needs, if you pay a lot of money for refractive surgery, then you have a shark in the back, which is a patient, and you are a doctor as a small fish. So that's why, despite excellent results in international studies, the MIOL implantation rate is only 1-5% internationally. We heard about that we have to compromise in the quality of vision in presbyopia correction because we do not have accommodative optics. So there are four optical principles left. Either you take monovision, and we know that monovision for far and reading would be a delta of -3 diopters, which is too much. Nearly nobody can get around with this. Though blended vision is a good idea to overcome this with a blended zone. I'll tell you later about that more. Then we do have refractive optics, and then we have diffractive optics. And I wanted to show this in a rising order of effects in the quality of vision.
Is there any clear-cut method that is kind of the best at this point, or it just depends on the circumstance?
No, surely not. Presbyopia correcting MRL-based surgery is absolutely individual, and you have to customize on the patient's personal needs. I'm going to talk about that later on as well.
Right on.
So let's have a look at the facts. The fact number one is that unavoidable side effects in lens-based surgery are there. We cannot talk against this. If you look at the physical optics, you will always have halo and glare in refractive surgery, correcting presbyopia, and you have more halo and glare when you have a refractive principle than a diffractive principle. Fact number two, halo and glare, as you can see here, rises with higher near addition. That's simply a fact. So when we talk about trifocal IOLs, we talk about the near addition of +3, +4. And yes, you can see here, it's quite a glare we have to deal with. So on the other hand side, having a look in between +1 and +2, the glare effect is minimal compared to a trifocal IOL.
Dr. Breyer, I have to say, I really like H&M as a retailer, but it sounds like H&G is a bad thing. So we got to remember H&G halo and glare, not very desirable, right?
Yeah, right. That's true. I wonder how tolerable some patients are. They really are, and they don't care about it. And them have a neuroadaption you can nearly not believe. But I don't think it's a mass product. It's very good for some people, but it's simply not a mass product. On the other hand side, as you can see here, it's still the most implanted IOL, a diffractive IOL is mostly implanted to correct presbyopia. as 80% of the patients, due to different studies, really perceive halo and glare. And this is with all trifocals IOL, and even worse with bifocal IOL. So this is the visual complication you're having with patients you implant trifocal MIOLs. It's photopic phenomena. And you have to tell this your patients upfront, because if you don't, they're really annoyed. It's very important to tell them that's the price you pay. And they often ask, but then I wear some filter glasses or yellow light glasses, and say, no, that's the price you have to pay. You have to accept. If you accept this, they're excellent. On the other hand side, you have a reduced vision because of reduced light transmission, dusk and dawn. That's also some compromising fact about trifocal IOLs in comparison to low-end EDOF IOLs. So another reason that the shark is behind you. So this is surely a fact I'm telling my patients: your contrast sensitivity, your vision at dusk and dawn will be reduced. And if you want to read at bad light conditions, you have to have a good light to read small print.
Well, I guess you don't want to be that fish with a trifocal IOL then, and if that shark's coming out of the shadows, not a good thing.
Yeah, but usually this happens in daylight, so. Okay. Anyway, I fear of sharks. If I jump into the sea, I always look to be back on the boat very fast. So let's have a look at retreatment options. That means if you implant the MIOL once and you have outliers, yes, very good. You can do an add-on IOL, you can do a smart surf transpier K, you can do a femto LASIK or Relax Smile corneal laser vision correction, that's fine. But if the patient wants better distance vision or reading vision, you can't really help. If he's not fine with a reduced contrast vision, you can't help. Complication management, halo and glare, not possible. They simply have to affect it. If they don't have a good neuroadaption brain, then they have a problem. Or if you do have a capsular break during surgery, that's really a bad thing, because you promised the patient to see without glasses after surgery. And unfortunately, Carl Zeiss Meditech was the only company who had a three-piece trifocal IOL you could implant in the sulcus, but they took it from the market. So finally, you have the risk that you have an unhappy patient. And what you see here is the unhappy patient on the right-hand side, that's a bird. What you never should do as a doctor, look away, but look at the patient and take his problems serious. Otherwise, he can get really aggressive.
That bird is definitely not 20 happy, as they say. So I guess, trifocal IOLs are perhaps not so well loved in the animal kingdom.
Yeah. True. So that's at the end. The problem you have when you implant trifocal IOL in the wrong patient. And I emphasize this, trifocal IOLs are wonderful, but only the right patient who accepts halo and glare. Let's go back a little bit to school. What have we learned before? Fact number one, if you do presbyopia correction, there's no way around halo and glare, but it's less with refraction than with diffraction. When you look at halo and glare and correlate it to the addition, the lower the addition is, the less halo and glare you achieve or you have to suffer from. Then monovision by itself can only be tolerated by, depending on the literature, 60 to 70 percent of the patients. Thanks Dan Reinstein for that excellent slide. But if you look at blended vision, 97% can tolerate blended vision. And this goes along very much with my experience doing Presbyon laser vision correction now for 12 years and doing the Düsseldorf formula with a low-end EDOF IOL for nearly 10 years now.
You know, that's such a huge difference. And I wonder if you could explain for our audience a little bit further, really the difference between monovision and blended vision. Why do you get that percentage difference?
The problem is when you do a real monovision, you would have to do that the patient is able to read. In the far dominant eye, you have to target for emmetropia. In the near dominant eye, you have to target for -3. And this huge difference can really be badly tolerated, though there's a low tolerance by patients if you use monovision. But when you use blended vision, then you add an EDOF effect. That means of nearly 1.5 diopters. Either you do it with laser vision correction or you do it with low ag progressive EDOF IOLs. Though the brain has a blended zone where both eyes can see, and that makes neuroadaption much more easy. And I myself can report about this because I had a blended vision, laser vision correction on my own 9 months ago. And it works absolutely perfectly. If I look outside, if I look at the PC, if I want to read, I never wore glasses since 9 months now.
Wow, congratulations.
Yeah, big help.
Yeah.
As we said, summarizing all this, facts number 1 to 4, the solution would be to use refractive low ad, progressive optics, and blended vision. That I think is a really good idea. So 10 years ago, we started to implant IOLs like that. And I remember that many of the peers looked at me like this and said, what's this guy doing? That's really strange. But I was very confident as I was happy with Presbyon laser vision correction. And I thought this is more or less copy-paste. That should also work. Once again, let's look back at the retreatment options we discussed before. With MOL, okay, that might cost you really some chair time in patients where you cannot fulfill their needs because it's a systematic problem. And that's what you sometimes as a doctor then would like to do, hide behind a tree, but you can't. And with a blended vision formula, you do have much more chances to correct outliers, to correct better distance vision, near vision, intermediate vision. A poor quality of vision is surely not the problem because the contrast sensitivity is nearly reduced in a very, very low matter. Usually patients don't even report about it if you don't ask them. If you have a capsular break as a complication, you can implant the femtis into the anterior rexis. And patients nearly never report about halo and glare. So you can be much more relaxed as a doctor and you don't have sometimes to hide behind a tree. So especially in times of social media, this is very, very important because the unhappy patient becomes an even more dangerous species in the times of social media. Personally, and this is also my opinion, I shared this with Sir John Marshall, is if I would implant an IOL in a younger patient, as it sometimes has to be, I would prefer a blue light filter in my family. So I'm very happy that Teleon now also offers a blue light filter IOL and the hydrophobic IOL for this patient groups.
And blue light filtering, I know that was controversial back in the early 2000s, but are most doctors convinced now that blue light filtering is indeed helpful?
I don't know if they are convinced, but we do many decisions. If you look at psychological studies, 90% of our decisions are, we say a gut feeling mm-hmm. in German. I don't know if this is a good English word for it, but 90% of our decisions, of course, are summarized by our experience, by our knowledge, but is a gut feeling. And if I would have the choice to implant a blue light filtering or a non-blue light filtering IOL in my family, I might prefer a blue light filter in IOL. Here you can see the implantation process. You can implant through a 2.0 millimeter incision, which doesn't induce any surgical astigmatism. And then the IOL unfolds very slowly and controlled. So I think it's also interesting for surgeons who have not so much experience, because as you can see, it unfolds slowly, very controlled. So this is also a very good IOL for beginners. Now I do remove the viscoelastic, and this is the unfolding process. It doesn't take too much time. It takes some time, but the big advantage, it's very controlled. And very seldom, we do have sometimes a capsular break. And as I said before, the retreatment option in trifocal IOL is close to none. You made a contract with a patient and you're not able to fill the contract anymore because you can't implant it in the capsular bag. So the good thing is, if this happens to you and you promised Acunex Vario or blended vision, you're still able to fulfill your promise as you implant the femtis and then clave it into the anterior rexis. Though, and to those who want to know more about this, there is now a publication from the University of Heidelberg, Florian Kretz, Detlev Holland, Zuni Shah, and us in the American Journal of Ophthalmology. Here you can say how you enclave the big haptics into the anterior rexis. Okay, and then there are two more small ones. Okay, so this is a conclusion. The good thing is that you have less photopic phenomena in low-end progressive refractive EDOF IOL. The contrast sensitivity is much closer to monofocal than to multifocal IOLs. So that means you have a better quality of vision than with multifocal IOLs. And that's why we think you have a really low chair option for happy patients and doctors, and you can relaxedly implant this IOL. Then the outlook into the future, and we are moving more and more towards this direction. As we have nothing to lose with this EDOF IOL, and there's always a win, we implant it now routinely in our private patients. And even you have a refractive error away from ametropia due to the defocus curve, you have a higher chance of happy patients. The only exceptions where we think about not to implant this IOL, if you have corneal spherical aberrations or higher order aberrations of more than 0.3. Okay, that's basically about it.
Well, thank you, Dr. Breyer. Excellent presentation. And I just have a few follow-up questions here for you. You know, the Acunex Vario, in a recent presentation, I saw you use the term varifocality. Explain to me what that is.
That's very good. It's a good and a tough and a smart question. So it's a mixture of refractive low ed in a segmental way. Exactly how it's done is really a secret of physical optics of the owners of the company. But what I can say over the years, it just worked fine. I didn't have problems with the IOL now over 10 years. I didn't have to explant a single one of these optics. So that's why I'm very confident with it.
That's great. And just to clarify, Acunex is a varifocal EDOF IOL, correct?
Correct. Yeah. And I think much more in the sense of what we think about EDOF IOLs. There's a very interesting discussion going on now in the scene. What's a real EDOF IOL? And I'm a little bit with Jorge Alio and Damien Gatineau. The only real EDOF IOL at the end is the pinhole IOL. And if there is another concept that comes close to real EDOF is this IOL or this optic, much more than diffractive optics with near addition of around about 2 diopters. They're also fine if you combine them with trifocal diffractive IOLs, but I think there are no real EDOF IOLs.
Now, again, I remember in the early 2000s doing articles about mix and matching with IOLs. This is a little different, but can you explain why couldn't any IOL work with blended vision?
You can only use refractive optics for blended vision. You can never use diffractive optics. So that's the main argument. Why? Because when a diffractive optic is away from emmetropia, we all know if this is more than 0.75 or 0.5 even, you have much more halo and glare.
Dr. Breyer, thanks for joining the program. You know, like diamonds, you're welcome back anytime. Just don't wait to come back with the new diamonds, as they would take billions of years to form.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting to have this, for me, nearly new format presenting and being interrogated in between. But I think it makes it much more interesting for the viewer and the listener and the auditorium. So thanks also for doing a great job, Matt. Thank you.